Welcome to the broadcast tonight, Robin Williams for the hour.
You're looking at now, and once you, it's at this age, to say you're playing characters now, which is what I always do, was doing before, but now it's a given.
Yeah.
You're heading towards Gabby time. Oh, good. Don't you see?
Yeah.
They haven't found any weapons. Don't you know what he's doing? Can't you see? He's trying to defuse the economy. He's letting people go, and they're hiring the man from the train. They got the guy who ran the railroads. Don't you see what's going on, Luke?
Well, come on, Corky. You let him go.
But it's that idea of, you know, playing these characters and doing this, it's been a great combination, like a really good year to just push the envelope. And I think that's always what I want to do, is to try different things and kind of always change perception.
One of my favorite people in the entire world, coming up for the hour when we continue.
No one from these isolated villages in China had ever attended university until the Coca-Cola system funded 1,000 first-generation scholarships for students to fulfill their college dreams, satisfying a thirst for opportunity. The Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. Studios in New York City. This is Charlie Rose.
Robin Williams is here. 2002 will go down as one of his busiest years to date. In addition to his performances in Death to Smoochie, Insomnia, and One Hour Photo, he also returned to stand-up after 16 years. His 20-city tour has been captured on the new CD, Live 2002, and his unforgettable live performance on HBO is now available on DVD. It is called Live on Broadway. Just take a look at Robin on stage.
India has the bomb, Pakistan has the bomb, China has the bomb, or maybe not, maybe they just have 1 billion people go boom.
Russia has the bomb. We have many bombs. We don't know where they all are. Maybe you want a dirty bomb.
I am pleased to have Robin Williams back at this table. Welcome back.
Thanks.
Here's my question.
Oh,
oh
yes.
My God. Oh, yeah. This is a question.
8 inches. Oh, yeah. No, that's what I like to do for a fishing pole. Just give a nice, you know, lead out 8 inches when you're fly fishing. Send it out there and let, you know, let the bass hook it and then pull on it. Either that or a piece of C4. You throw that in there. How you, but that's good. You see the bass fishermen there? I don't always have that thing where you put it out there and the bass are like, I'd like to sit out there and you just, you know, a little C4 and then they come right up.
Do they really?
Right to the surface.
Oh, right up. You
yeah,
know, you almost reach out and grab them.
Well, you can, what's left of them. It's nice when you get a full fillet. Yeah. I agree. Oh, yeah. Your question, I'm sorry.
Here's
I ran
my
away.
Question.
Sure.
What went into the preparation of this extraordinary performance?
Oh, well, it was started off in San Francisco in a small club for about 3 weeks. At a
okay,
place
but stop there. Before you went to that, I mean, had you been thinking about it? Had you been writing for 6 months? Had
no,
you been
I kind of, well, there was a tribute to Whoopi Goldberg in Washington. It was about 2 months after September 11th. And the weird thing is people treated it like we had just lifted the siege of Richmond. Which
yeah.
is an old Southern reference, but Strom will remember.
Yeah.
And it's that idea that people were just like, wow, and it was like they had not had any entertainment till then. And it was the idea of going back out, and everyone came up and said, oh, thank you. And it was like, well, maybe it's time to go back out. People needed it. And then I started off performing in San Francisco and just seeing what worked. And also here in New York at a place called Comedy Underground, which was a little club. And I saw comics coming back out because they said for a while it was almost like a no-fly zone, literally. They didn't, what was funny, and there were some really gutsy people doing some wonderful things, but it was just coming back out and being able to talk about it, talk about what's happening with the country at that point, you know, with, you know, the tightened security and Rumsfeld coming out every so often going, I don't know where, I don't know when,
but
something awful is going to happen.
Yes.
Can you give us a clue? Not at all. It was yes. like the Central Intuitive Agency.
So the material was all there, just sitting
yeah,
up there.
Yeah, there's a lot of material, there's a lot of stuff to talk about, still is, every day, you know, now weapons inspectors in Iraq going, do you have any weapons? Not today! Thank you. Yes. We're busy! Hello? Yes, do you have any biological weapons? Hello, Khanimishare! Biological! Yogurt. I love when they go to his palace and all the news crews. You can't come in here!
And then, so he's inspecting, come on in!
Come on in!
Come on in!
Look, look what we have! Cold cuts, cheeses, all of the things!
and a picture of our leader.
Of our leader, Uncle Saddam. Yes, like Joe. Exactly. It's like Stalin going, I love you! I love the fact they had elections, and he won unanimously. But yes, no one runs against him.
No. Who ran? And no one votes against him either.
No. You're like, did you vote against Saddam? Yes. Will you please come with us? Let me show you what you have won. It's a gift. What is a gift? Come, quick, get in the car. But also, you know, it's the same thing.
Think about your family, though.
Think about your family also. And what is it now? They just agreed they're doing Operation Inner Look, which is basically the virtual war that they've been preparing for.
That's right.
Basically, you know.
We'll figure out how we're going to do it.
Oh, yeah. We're playing it online.
Yes.
You've got mail. It's uh-oh.
Yeah, see, but then
my God, the stocks are going down, too.
You know, I mean, some make this point, serious point, that so much of war is that way today.
Virtual
war. We forget, you know, where the rubber meets the ground, you know.
Yeah, well, I just got back from Afghanistan.
Tell me about that.
Well, you go and you see people, you know, the other part of any war is the occupation of, you know, like with Afghanistan. Yes, there was the initial, you know, fighting of the war. Now it's this kind of, you know, occupying and defending and, you know, keeping the... Basically monitoring the borders to keep, because the Taliban keep coming back.
Yeah.
And you'd say, at a certain point, they say, but when do they, because we have hardcore night vision capabilities, you know, goggles that can actually see through people. Like, oh my God, you have, what a lovely thing. When you walk around, you see all these guys going, hi, Mr. Williams, nice to see you. Oh, yeah. But, you know, that part is you see people over there, and we'll be there. Some have been there for a year, some have, you know, If we go into Iraq, you'll see people who'll be there for, you know, locked off in basically the northern frontier. And that's the second part of people occupying and trying to just now start to rebuild Afghanistan, which is a big, big job.
Yeah.
It's one of the most heavily mined countries in the world. It's going to be a long time before they have the Afghan open, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it? It's wild. It just blew a wheel off.
Do you have any capacity, opportunity to talk to people that's not away from? In other words, is there any chance for you to interact with...
Afghanis.
Yeah, Afghanis.
I met only a few. I met some that were like, they obviously were the guy wearing the Dolphins t-shirt, you know, had come back.
Yeah.
So you've been here all day? Yeah. Oh, no. The people coming back, some were, I think, in the civilian capacity of rebuilding teachers and architects, you know. But Gram sits, they told me that used to sit in one of the most fertile valleys in Afghanistan, and then throughout the 10-year war with the Soviets, they blew up all the aqueducts, and now is, you know, it's basically like the Dust Bowl.
It's just awful. It's
amazing to see. You expect to see Henry Fonda going, well, you can't get out.
Yeah.
And I met only a few. I mean, a few basically, you know, expatriate Afghanis coming back to rebuild. And everything you see around is pretty much blown up. I mean, if a guy had an aluminum siding business, big money. And, you know, it's basically...
Somebody's going to hear you say that tonight, is
going
to say.
This guy going... Earl! Bobby, come on, we can make a killing over there. There's a lot of roofs out.
Yes, exactly.
They got problems with mice. No, that's bullet holes.
Can you say
crazy.
Kabul? Can you say Kabul?
Kabul. Come down to Kabul. All of these houses can be built in only moments. Calling now. What did it? Come on down to Club Burka. That's also another thing when you go to Afghanistan, you think an Afghani transvestite. Who would know? What are you doing? Hello, beauty. Very difficult. But in answer to your question, I'd only met a few Afghanis, and I think they had just come back. And I met a lot of soldiers, men, women, you know, and they were just happy someone remembered them because, you know, it tends to be, if it's out of the headlines, people forget, but, you know, we have a lot of people there.
And you know, people are not thinking about Afghanistan. I mean, it wasn't that
short
time ago.
Yeah, there's other stands, you know, a series of stands. I went to Turkey.
Oh, to Kazakhstan, and
Uzbekistan, and Laurelstan. Yeah. And then you go to Pakistan, which is where we have this, you know, relationship where it's, you know, they have a base within a Pakistani air base.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a very unusual thing. And they have, the Pakistanis have guardhouse, you know, they have these little, I said, who's that? They said, that's the picket post where the Pakistanis are protecting the air base. And the guy lives, his house is the guardhouse. What are you doing? I live here. No one is going to get by me. This is my home and my guard post. And you're going, oh, that's good for defense.
Yeah. Now, did you go for the U.S. government? They sent you over there?
They sent me there. I went there with blessings of Dick Cheney and a lot of Enron stock.
Did they ask you to go, or did you go on your own?
I went on my own. Excuse me. We'll work for laughs. Excuse me, going to Kabul? They gave me a ride. They put me on a C-17, which is basically a plane big enough to carry Anna Nicole Smith. You know, back her up, Bobby! The sides are open. And then they put you on C-130s, which are the same, the loud plane. You know, just the guys are wearing, you know, you have to have, and you get off going, that was a great flight! Thank you! And you go off the back, you know, it's basically like a plane for the incontinent, the back drops. And, you know, and then as you get closer, as you, I knew things were strange as we got over Afghani airspace and we're just about to land. They do two things, a combat landing, which is where they spiral in so you make less of a target. And the second thing, we were in a, because it's a coalition effort, I was flying on a Spanish plane with these guys called El Toros. And they go, Ro, it's okay, we're just going to put on some Kevlar now. And they start strapping in and putting on the full battle helmets. Going, but if you want to stay up here, it's okay. You know, we just do this as procedure. And the guys, shh, go off the plane, keep running. Get off the plane, stay on the path. Don't run on the other side of the path. You will be safe.
Hello, Mr. Williams, nice to have you here. If you just step over here, we'll begin your comedy routine. There are five men over there in the bunker. Just make them laugh and move on, sir.
You know, it's like a lot of that. We put on shows, it was, you know, there'd be just a stage. We walked into one thing, and there was a room full of 300 guys, men and women.
Right.
And you just, you know, go at it. But it wasn't like I couldn't do the regular show. It's this show, but for them. But it was fun. They were just ready to laugh.
But you changed it to them, for them.
Not a thing. They just did the full thing, full tilt. Nothing, no censorship, because I just did it.
No, I don't mean censorship. I mean you made it.
We talked a lot about the stuff for them.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, basically. I mean, well, you know, they have, you talk about all the things that, you know, a lot of times I said, you know, they're not, even though it's, you know, they're men and women, they're not allowed to have contact. So basically I said, right now you got more semen than the Fifth Fleet. And they give them non-alcoholic beer. They're not like, in a lot of places, it's Muslim country, but also they don't want people going on patrol now. Everybody, woo! So they give them non-alcoholic beer, which is basically, yeah, it's like a Nerf vibrator. Not going to do much. Guys have two non-alcoholic beers going, woo,
nothing.
And, you know, and you talk about the place, you know, the just where they are in the middle of everything. And they start to build a routine kind of around that, and these planes and the helicopter and all the weapons. They have the Predator, which is that manned drone.
Oh, you saw a Predator?
I saw a Predator. It's basically a flying dildo. They call it, they call it Little Fokker.
This is the thing that came down.
Yeah, this is the thing that, when they arm them, is lethal, but most of the time they're just doing surveillance. But it looks like, basically, a vibrator with wings. And I nicknamed it the Little Fokker, F-O-K-K-E-R. And they went, oh, okay.
Oh, it's okay.
Yeah, but it's, but you see that. You see all of these things, these, you know, the things that they're doing, monitoring those mountains and continuing to look for Mr. L.
Everybody goes over there and talks to these soldiers, they'll say they're terrific.
Yeah,
kids.
There's a sense of, you know, because number one, it's, you know, that's a volunteer army.
Yeah.
There's no sense of, you know, I mean, they would love to come home soon, but they know what they're doing and they still are, they know that they have to, you know, protect this kind of tentative Afghan government. When the Minister of Tourism is killed at the airport, bad for business.
Yeah, yes,
come back to...
And they almost got the president, too.
Yeah, and that alone, and, you know, still, you know, it's like the Wild West. They have to... Everyone, you know, they sell Kalashnikovs on the street, like, hello, look, look, for the family, look, you know. And they have what's called celebratory fire every time there's a wedding, you know. Everybody down!
Well, isn't that what happened when they had some of the friendly fire? They said they thought it were firing on us and there was a wedding. And
it was a wedding. And it's basically
and
like...
40 people got killed.
Yeah. It's basically, you know, the Smith & Wesson wedding party. You know? It's a very... If you see the country from the air, it looks devastated, except for small valleys where there's total green. And then you'll see the one building with a satellite dish, and that's a warlord's house. who's got cable? Come on, my friend. But they're all out. And you meet the special forces guys. They look like heavily armed Amish.
Yeah. Full, they're beard, all, yeah, exactly.
Full beards and burkas. And even the Irish guy with the red beard. Shut up. I'm here with the forces. I'm here with the English.
This is our camouflage.
Yeah, this is a camouflage. Oh, but they also, because it's the coalition forces, they have Norwegians, Swedish, and they bring their own camouflage, which is designed for Norway and the mountains.
It's
and
white.
Yeah, white with little flecks of green. It's kind of weird. I feel like a Christmas tree in the Sahara.
And some of these guys ride horses, too. Some of these Special Forces guys are on horseback.
To. I'll get on the pony. We're going in the mountains and bring the RPG, Corky.
Yeah. Any talk of Osama when you were there?
No talk. Just, you know, there's the other thing. You see these boards, which is like a huge... It's like a chat room. They have these giant things. This isn't giving away. It's just that they have, you know... There's little dots, and that's everybody who's out there, and they know, you know, they're looking.
They're listening, too.
Listening
is what they're doing.
Yeah. I was also knowing that, you know, with some of these remote control, like the Predator or whatever, all it just takes is one Pakistani with a remote control plane going, look, I'm messing with the billions of dollars. I could screw with you. But I think, yeah, they're checking all over and listening and monitoring and, you know, just trying to maintain. But that's the second part of the equation of people there. That's what you're looking for if you... Keep pushing.
think we're making a big mistake to go in Iraq?
God, no. It's you know, if they have, someone said, if, you know, they keep saying, we know things,
right.
Then give us a clue, Sparky, bigger than a bread box. You remember, you know, the Cuban Missile Crisis, there was a,
I have pictures
yeah.
here of missiles, if you see here and here.
Adlai Stevenson.
Yeah, Adlai Stevenson. That is not a harvester. That is
right.
A SAM missile sight.
Yeah, you can't just
have that. They have aluminum siding! Those are pipes for air conditioning!
You know, but the idea of even finding it when you have, you know, weapons that could be put in the back of a truck, when they said, they, oh, if, we look at this, okay, we're gone. You have to look for, you know, the dogs are going, even the drug, you know, drug-sniffing dogs are going, it's hard. It's not, you know, they move around like this giant carnival coming to look for things, you know. Secret surprise, yeah. You know.
Has a certain inevitability about it, doesn't it?
It becomes that way, but then you look at the whole world going, wait a minute, are you doing this for what reasons? And, but then you have the Iranians and everyone saying, we will help you. What a little piece of the action.
Yeah, that's
just
right.
Some oil. Oh, I'm asking, just some oil.
That's right. That's
and meanwhile,
right.
The Saudis are going, don't look at us. Don't look at us. We are, no, nothing is wrong. Yeah. What are you doing?
What was it? There's a famous quote attributed to, I think, a Turkish leader who said in 91, the Turks would like to be part of the chefs and not part of the menu.
Ooh, ooh. Oh, there's that joke that's online about the Saudis calling Bush, saying, Mr. Bush, we're most horrified by the most recent attack upon your country. And he goes, what most recent attack? There's a small break, and they go, oh, 11-hour time difference. Oh. It's like, oh, what are we doing? Oh, it's in, at this point, you know, you have to, it's still you hope that, they, you know, if they find something, that'll be good. If they find, and just say, okay, now disarm.
Yeah.
Because going in again is just, oh no. Even the cost alone, what do they say, $1 trillion? What's
amazing.
That many zeros among friends? You know, when you have former Enron employees as Secretary of the Army. Bob, how you doing? I'm okay.
Secretary of the Army.
Yeah, I can't go there right now. Just a subpoena envy. All those people. Ken, where are you going?
Did you get any sense of the attitude about the United States, how the people over there feel about us? Like in Kazakhstan.
Because
is that one of the stands you
went
to?
Well, the one is Kazakhstan. Uzbekistan is a very, very, basically,
you know, a lot of oil there.
I don't know if there's not a lot of oil in Uzbekistan. They're basically one of the former Soviet republics, so
right. They
have a lot of equipment. Like their air force is 4 planes, three of them they use for parts. And one time, the guy was going up to fly, and they fly, and we give them fuel. They don't have enough money even for fuel, but we give them fuel, so they go in there. We can go up in the air. So they go up at night, which is weird because they don't have the radar to bring the planes back down.
Yeah.
All they have is 2 searchlights with guys cranking to get them back. You know, follow it in. Oh! And there was a guy at his cockpit. His plane, you know, they were trying to close the cockpit. It wouldn't close, so they got 2 guys out with hammers and went. Take off. They were just happy to have the parts.
Sounds like Dr. Strange.
Yeah, it's like.
Or, we are happy to. We are very happy to have American menu.
And they're, you know, basically, you know, living off of anything we give them.
Yeah.
It was strange. And Pakistan was a base within a base. The one place that was kind of unusual was Kyrgyzstan, which is in the foothills of the Himalayas.
Yeah.
And they're hoping to get, like, business, tourist business back there, kind of to compete with, you know, coming to say, come see Mount Everest, you know, from here.
Yes, from our side.
from our side. But yeah. It seemed to be a very sweet country. And mostly very interesting mix of Russian and Tajik and very much like, hello, do you have any blue jeans for now? I have your movie. I have 1-hour photo before it came out. I got offline from you. Very good movie. I love this movie. Very funny.
And you said, what about copyright? And they said,
the copyright.
Yeah, we copyright.
Right, I copied right, it works. You copy it wrong, it don't play. It's bad that way. You know, the Thai.
What's your problem?
Thing.
I like the movie.
Movie, good. I put out in the Thailand many times.
Used to see people that get movie cameras, they would go into theaters. That's how they
do
it.
Oh, sure, that's what
and
it
then
is.
You'd see people walking in your movie, or the one guy who went to shoot Platoon was an hour late, so they would sell the movie with 1 hour missing. You know, it's like, hey, all right, you know.
Anywhere you wanted to go that you've never been? Badly. Oh, I mean, you've been to China.
I would love to go to China. No, I've never been to China.
Nor have I
also want to go to Africa. I mean,
God, me too. I mean, yeah. I, you know, I mean, the list of places that I want to go is much larger than the places
that you can. Exactly. And it's also the place, I mean, like with Africa, you'll be prepared, we'll make arrangements, and then all of a sudden there'll be something come from the Center for Disease Control. And all of a sudden, CDC said, malaria, really bad.
Yes.
Typhoid, and then there's a form of prophylactic resistant malaria.
Which, right.
You know, all of a sudden it's like, okay, you know, even Guanamadia, and it's like the old Englishman going, I remember the Zambezi. Oh, will you excuse me?
Yes, exactly.
And it just comes back to me every so often. Cold sweats. Yes. And there I am. Oh, there. Oh! Oh, my God, I seem to have soiled myself. You mean, of course, in the jungle you would have. No, just now when I made that noise. I've soiled myself.
But it's Africa I'd love to go to and see, you know, just to see all these animals before they go, before they end up in Disney World going. And China.
And China.
And many parts of, you know, that whole kind of what they call the Pacific Rim. I mean, I just went to Fiji, which was gorgeous. Oh, amazing country.
What's it like?
It's very, it's a wonderful combination of like Tahiti and it's almost like a gospel reunion because they sing and dance at everything. You know, and in the old days they were eating someone.
Yeah.
It's like when you go to, you know, you go to New Zealand and they have the haka where they meet you and go, And supposedly the first time they met That's the great. English, when they landed, the Englishman dropped eye contact and he went, poof. You're supposed to just keep looking at them. They go,
your mama.
And if you look away, they go, I bet people are thinking right now, they're going, is this Charlie Rose? Didn't he start off wild noises? It's like getting Mary McKeever's answering machine. You have reached the Pygmy Hotline. If you wish to continue, press 1.
Now, when you come here, this is what they expect.
Yeah, they know. They're not looking for, like, you know.
This is not.
They're not looking for Arthur Miller's daughter. You're going to talk about acting and writing. They're just going, boy's going to make noises. Little man's going to, going to go to Fiji, come back. We'll be dancing around, talking about going to Africa, maybe getting to China.
Look over here. We have a beautiful new Disneyland with Mickey Mouse. And this is Tin Men Square. And we have a shirt made by American prisoners. Called Credibility Gap T-shirt made by American prisoners.
You didn't know they were here?
No, you didn't know all T-shirts are shipped back, all made by political prisoners for the Gap. Crazy now, but we are moving.
What did this tour do for you vis-a-vis your sense of wanting to make sure you stayed in touch with Stan?
It's just good to get back out in front of people. You know, you get a certain, you get a feeling after playing all over the country, you just see that people, number one, had a kind of a, it was like many people said, I haven't laughed that hard in a long time.
Let me tell you a story about me.
Sure.
As you know, I had heart surgery.
I remember that.
Yes. I was laughing. I saw it like 4 or 5 days after.
Oh, that's bad news.
I had to stop. I said, this is not good for me.
Not good.
This is not good.
Not good when the doctor's going, kitty, kitty, Charlie, Bobby. A woman said that too, that she had had, you know, some surgery and she said she had to, or people, literally people come and say,
absolutely.
Thank you, but I had to quit. They said it was great. I was laughing my ass off. But thank you. I had to, you know.
Well, there's a review that somewhere said, you should not watch this in one viewing.
Kind of like a nice piece of cheese. Like barbecue. Yeah. Spread it out over a while.
Yeah,
good animal like that, you don't eat all at once.
Have a nice bite, put it away, and come back.
Come back, like turkey. You know, come back again. It's like, you know, that piece of pork. I think, there were people who said that it really kind of was, because there's that big kind of cathartic thing that happened with people. That was worth it when you saw people just coming up and saying, oh man, I laughed. That, especially knowing what we've been through, what we'll continue to go through.
Yeah.
People need it, and that's the purpose of going out and doing it. That's why I went to Afghanistan, just to say, hey, you're not forgotten, come here, but also just to give a taste of, you know, something to kind of act as a respite from all of that.
I'm not sure if I'm proud of this question, but I want to ask it anyway. Does it bring you real satisfaction to know that you can entertain,
What are you not proud of about
that? Well, I do, you know, it sounds stupid.
That you can entertain people?
Yeah, that you know. Does it give you pride? Does it give you a great sense of,
It's a great sense of purpose on that level because there is that kind of, you could see it affects people for however long.
Right.
There is, And sometimes, you know, sometimes a thing will have a half-life where people will kind of say, like, there's a routine in this that seemed to take off in a big way, this thing about golf, the invention of golf.
Oh, stop, stop.
Stop, okay. We'll be right back.
Roll tape.
Roll tape.
This is my favorite.
This is why, because I play golf.
Here's my idea for a f***ing sport. I knock a ball in a gopher hole.
Oh, you mean like pool?
F*** off pool! Not with a straight stick, with a little f***ed up stick. I whack the ball that goes in a gopher hole.
Oh, you mean like croquet?
F*** croquet! I put the hole hundreds of yards away! Oh, f*** hell yeah! It's great fun there! Oh yeah, that's a great thing!
Oh, like a bowling thing.
F*** no! Not straight, I put in the way! Like trees and bushes and high grass, so you can lose your f***ing ball and go whacking away with a f***ing tire iron. Whacking away, and each time you miss, you feel like you're gonna have a stroke. That's what we'll call it. A stroke, because every time you miss, you feel like you're gonna f***ing die. Oh, great. Oh, and here's a better part. Oh, f***, this is brilliant. Right near the end, I'll put a flat piece with a little flag to give you f***ing hope. But then I'll put a pool and a sandbox to f*** with your ball again. Ah, you'll be there trashing your ass, jerking away in the sand.
Oh, you do this one time.
F*** no. 18 f***ing times.
Well, our cards are... cards and letters are coming in now.
Oh, yes. We'll hear from them.
Yeah.
That is... where did that come from?
It came from playing a drunken Scotsman one night, and I was, because I go to Scotland almost every year to see Billy Connolly for his birthday.
He's a great man.
And I just started playing, because, you know, you go to Scotland and you get off the plane, and even though it's supposed to be English, you can't understand it. It's like, go to team up here, eh? Tell the rules, a quick show. See, so I did watch it all late that day. Really? Yeah, that's a tip. Could have got the save it. See, that's saying, a TV, I'll go to play. It's such a shit.
Oh, yeah.
And you were looking for subtitles. So I just started to play that. And then one night I started to talk about, you know, that here's a country that could, you know, the men could wear a skirt and, you know, and a tiny accessory on the front. And play a dead cat as a musical instrument. You know what? Put a hose in its ass and keep it blowing. And then it got into golf, and it just started to build. Because
were you sitting around with Billy, or you would just...
No, just did it on stage.
Oh, on stage.
It started off as one idea of just, you know, here's my idea for a sport. You think, who hit the first ball? You know, it started in Scotland. And if you play in Scotland, then it is really just, you know, grouse. And in the grouse, I mean the gorse, which is like this really thick grass, and in the grouse live in the gorse. Yeah. And the English hunt the gorse like, oh, I shot the grouse today, killed 800. Dear God, it was good eating. I have bad teeth, too. And then, you know, playing golf in this insane place on the moors, which are, you know, just bleak. Let's make a sporting group out of it. Use as much of this god-awful land as we can find. And then they turn it into an exclusive sport where now Hody won't let the women play. He won't let the women.
Oh,
Hody not going to get any booty for a long time. And they have no sponsors.
But that was Hody's decision.
No,
that was not the sponsor's decision.
So Hody said, I'm not having any sponsors.
Yeah.
We're going to keep it all that way.
Yeah, I'll show you we can do it.
Yeah, Tiger, you still in? Son of a black man and a Thai woman, are you still in? Crouching Tiger, hidden putt. It's like, oh, this golf is just such a bizarre sport for me. It's just, you can dress like a pimp, no one cares, you know?
Yeah.
And it's so exciting, too.
Dress like a pimp and no one cares.
Yeah, and the commentary is just like, you're on the third green now. And even you can hear the... That's when I go, oh, come on. But, you know, people, I know why people play it. You know, they get, so it's time away where you go in this place. It's kind of very...
Oh, that's exactly what it is.
Yeah, people, for me, that's riding a bike. I ride a bike, road bikes, you know, bicycles, human powered, not, you know, motorcycle. But, you know, I can go be on a bike for 2 hours and just head off, you know, and be...
Up the mountain and then down the mountain.
Yeah, up and down the mountain. And that's why I go every year and I see the Tour de France, because it's... For me, it's one of the great long-distance sporting events in the world, and I support Brother Armstrong.
Brother Armstrong, who'll be here tomorrow.
Oh, good man. Good man.
What's interesting about that is you mentioned Billy Connolly. You go over to Scotland for his birthday every year.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, his birthday this year was a big celebration, but yeah, I go over there every year.
Right,
they have this Lonic Festival, which is fun.
Lance Armstrong's a good friend.
Right.
I know. I mean, you seem to be someone that celebrates friendship.
Oh, you got to. When you have great friends like, you know, Billy, you mentioned Billy Crystal, Billy Connolly, and, you know, many are famous, many aren't, but it's it's kind of as, I mean, as you hit 50, and Charlie, you are knowing that new heart, too. that becomes very precious. Wonderful thing to have people that amazing, you know, and yeah. to be with them is great. I mean, to like to even ride with Lance is like an amazing thing. You feel like for a brief moment, like I'm it, and then you realize he was just warming up. No, I'll be with Billy Connolly, who's hysterical, or hanging out with Billy Crystal, who's one of her, Chris Reeve, who's a, you know, who's the godfather of my son, and just an amazing
human
being.
God, he was here recently. I mean, do you just...
Yeah, I mean, he's
the inspiration for the sheer sense of the determination and the belief.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, it's power of will is carrying him through to the point where now, you know, he does this thing, we had dinner, and he said, brother, watch, and he moved his finger, and I went, okay, where's the string? You know, I expect him to sit up and go, I feel time.
Yeah, I know.
Miracle! The baby Jesus put me in the house!
But, you know, and all it was.
That. And that and, is
but
the
that's a journey of 1,000 miles.
Big time. It's the thing of, you know, pushing the human envelope as much as Lance is pushing it when he rides Mont Ventoux in 58 minutes.
Yeah.
And all the French going, oh, no big deal.
It's steroids. It's all steroids.
And they hold it. They keep, you know, they watch him and they're there like this. And every year, this kind of wonderful association of people who. Like, even when things, after I won the Academy Award, I picked up the phone one night, hello, Club Paradise. Who is this? Click. Just comedians, friends, just going,
not everything's great, buddy. Hey, Mr. Academy Award, what happened there?
Click. You know, they bust that's your heart, you know. Yeah. But that's part of it. That's part of the drill when you have friends like that.
I mean, it would think that comedians may have a certain brand of friendship because...
Oh, it's tough, you know, but it's a tough love
because
business.
It's a tough love business. And because in the beginning, everybody was hanging out at the club, just watching and learning.
Yeah, and you're there together, and then you kind of go...
A shared pain.
Oh, yeah, a mutual. Here we are there, dead men walking.
Yes.
Dead men talking. It's like that thing of, you know, and then you go your separate ways, but you'll see people and go, oh, what's up, you know?
Yeah.
And it's very interesting. Like, I saw Richard Pryor a month ago. He came up and he wanted to go see San Quentin, come back. Yeah. He wanted to see Alcatraz. And we took him to the island. It was amazing.
You took Richard Pryor to Alcatraz.
Yeah, and he got him off, too.
Yeah. but he just...
He wanted to go see it. And it was amazing.
Did he call you and say, or just somebody said,
Robin, get me to the island. Yeah. I want to go to the island.
And you know San Francisco. I know you do, brother.
Yeah.
Take me to the island.
You know Willie, too. You get Willie to
Brown.
Open the door.
Willie Brown.
Yeah.
Willie Brown, hardest working man in show business. Willie Brown, working up. Brother, please. I want to say that it's an honor. Yo, sister, please. Willie Brown, working the room.
Yeah.
But it was so good to know him. And Jonathan Winters, he came up. The weird thing is for Jonathan, his wedding anniversary is September 11th.
Yeah.
Rough day, so
yeah, right.
I took him to a Giants game, and you know, it was so great to have him and his wife up, and you know, just he had a good day. And for me, knowing him, meeting comedians like Jonathan, Don Rickles, oh man, that's just, and you stand and you're like a little
kid,
a brother, but more like uncle or like the master, the sensei, Buddha.
Yeah,
when around Jonathan, it's like being around the great one.
Oh, I remember when.
He did a great thing. A man was kissing a woman in front of us, and they were doing it for a long time, and he leaned over and said, he's sucking the ugliness out of her. Not so loud, John. But you hang out with those guys and you can't help but feel, you know. And someone like, I got to know Rod Steiger before he died. And for me, the stories, he would just, you want to get that stuff on tape sometimes so people could hear all the stuff that, you know, these guys have gone through, like Walter Matthau. And meeting those people, or the few times, once or twice I met Billy Wilder, that there's such a gift that they give you this kind of sense of history, but, you know, like a knowledge born of, you know, great history, like Walter being in the Battle of the Bulge and Steiger
Walter Matthau was in the Battle of the Bulge?
Big time.
Right.
And Steiger was on a destroyer. Serious?
Wow.
And these guys will tell you, and those stories alone, you're like this, and then they'll tell you, you know, being in plays and doing movies, and then... It's this amazing thing, because all those guys who came out of World War II kind of went into acting as kind of like this thing you do on the G.I. Bill.
Yeah,
like,
right.
Steiger said he went to an acting class because he heard girls were there.
Yeah.
It wasn't kind of, the theater's going, there's chicks.
I know.
It's crazy. I don't know what to do.
I think a lot of actors got started that way.
I think
a lot
too. And comics, too. Yeah, what's that girl doing? Hey. It's like the old guy, you know, the comic making level. That was wonderful. What show did you see, first or second? Yes, that old, that thing.
But no,
that's
old,
a music
that's very
old joke. Yeah, bring it back. I remember that joke from 1929.
But the same thing is to be said. Do you ever, I think about like Winters. Somebody ought to be sitting with him and having a forever conversation about recording. I got a call last night from a friend of mine saying, this happens to me a little bit, and I don't have time to do as much of it as I ought to. And somebody said to me, I had the most amazing dinner last night. And he named the guy that he had dinner with. Mm-hmm. And he said, he's got the most fabulous stories about the beginning of Hollywood.
Oh, yeah.
And he said, you have got to talk to the guy.
You got to. And you got to get it.
Yeah, exactly.
You have to get it down on, you know, in some medium that won't go away.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I remember. But, you know, you hear from all of them and they tell you stories that you're just going, oh, my God. And it's. You know, it's like hearing the first, you know, the audition tapes of, you know, Jimmy Stewart. Ah, line. You know, you want to hear all these things, and you know, and they tell you stuff that you just—that's hysterical, and but also powerful. You know, coming through the depression. You know, making movies and you know, being in movies with like people that they, you know, like Bogart talking with you know Don Rickles and all these people, and there's this amazing interaction, and meeting Brando. I got to meet him once.
And?
It was insane. It was wonderful to see him just to go, Robin, this man. And I'm just going, oh, you know, there he is. And he's going, I don't know, it's crazy. Give me butter. But he was, he's an amazing guy. All of these guys have so much to tell and teach. Yeah. And that's, Brando actually put together an acting class and, you know.
Oh, and put it on tape.
Yeah.
Have
so,
you seen
I mean,
the
I think,
did,
no.
Didn't he get guys like you to help him?
Yeah, people came and showed up. But now, I think here's what he's doing is kind of doing what you talked about, giving back and, you know, saying, kind of sharing what he knows, and it sometimes he'll ramble on and say, I don't know what that means. sometimes he just says something, you go, whoa, it is that kind of Buddhist moment.
Yeah, you do have it. I mean, there are moments in which you just say,
yeah, there is a Zen Cohen,
yeah,
you know.
Exactly.
And then there's Sam Cohen, and then there's a time to show business in those days. There was no movies. We were just doing this in front of a cave wall. How many Cro-Magnons does it take to light a fire? And it was all of this stuff that they tell you. Yeah, I think you have to get it on tape, and it helps to have people. Just, you know, being like a catalyst and just letting them go, because they'll tell you stuff, and it's all, then they want to tell you stuff, you know? Yeah. And it's important because it's almost, it's like the verbal record, or visual, verbal and visual both, because they light up, because you see them talk about it, and they just remember it, and and it's like, oh, yeah, baby.
To have an audience again.
It's even an audience, or someone, it's the audience again combined with, and remembering it again, and it's a wonderful thing.
You'd be surprised. I mean, I went today to the funeral service for Rune Arledge.
Right.
Rune Arledge changed news and sports television, as you know, as well as I do. I don't think he ever did a great interview. I mean, I tried to get him here, and he didn't, you know. And then Bill Paley never did an interview. Two people right there who had huge impact on the industry that I worked in. Never, you know. And it's just
the
stories like that are legendary.
You know, you want to hear the story of, like, Cronkite on the air when, you know, Lyndon Johnson said, you know, get him off. I want to talk to him. You know, that thing, you know. That, you know,
while Lyndon Johnson's watching him, and you basically said, if Walter's against me, we've lost the war.
Oh, yeah.
And then did somebody call up Walter?
Oh, that was a famous rumor about Johnson that he said when he was running for governor in Texas years and years ago. He said, I want you to spread a rumor that my opponent has sex with chickens. He said, Lyndon, we can't do that. He said, I know. I just want to see him deny it. You know. That's Southern politics.
That's good.
You know, you got a great tradition of that under the Manson-Nixon line. That's where you get those politicians.
The Manson-Nixon line. Yeah.
What was the governor of Louisiana, the last governor? The guy who got busted.
Oh, Edwards.
Edwin Edwards. Who
right,
said
Edwin.
One time they said, isn't it true, Governor Edwards, that you took a bribe for $10,000? He said, that's ridiculous. I've never taken a bribe for $100,000. It's like, that's that, you know, the Huey Long School of Diplomacy. Put it out there. Don't be afraid.
Edwards also said, there's no jury will ever convict me in Louisiana unless I'm found with a dead woman or a live boy.
Yeah. Bingo. We're talking it out now. Because, you know, Louisiana right there, we vote everything, just move on down there. That's why we could burn something, burn a piece of chicken and sell it up north. Is that too fair? Down here, it's crisp, it's burnt. Up there, we say blacking. Yeah, the burnt, we burn it up.
Yeah,
turn your
right.
lower track into an e-ticket. Everything be flying out your ass. We send it up north and say, oh, good Cajun cooking.
Yeah, it's Cajun.
Oh, no, of course, you have to put everything in the mix there.
Blacken.
Jambalaya.
Blacken.
Jambalaya. You're like roadkill in a pot.
Did you were at a point now. You just came off this tour, which I've held up several times.
Yes, we pimped it enough.
We pimped it enough. One hour photo.
Autofocus is
not a movie.
I didn't do that. I swear there's no tape. Hey, how are you doing?
Hey.
I see nothing. Look at the tapes. Yeah, no, one hour photo.
I didn't make those tapes.
No.
It was not me.
Yeah, and they're back on.
One hour photo, Insomnia.
Right.
this, which is very different.
Yeah.
You know, all the things that you were honored for, you think the characters like Good Will Hunting, what was it?
Yeah, Good Will Hunting was, yeah. Won the Academy Award for that.
Is there any place that you want to be?
I think where I am right now, it's a good place.
That's exactly right. Yeah. Talk to me about that just a little
bit. I will share with you.
Oh, share.
Testify, brother.
Yeah, please.
It is that feeling of being, you know, doing like the stand-up combined with one-hour photo insomnia, you know, kind of pushing the envelope in terms of what people perceive I can do, mm-hmm. especially in playing a character, you know, these darker, you know, troubled, and in many cases, you know, nasty, vicious. And that helps to just, you know, push it through because you're looking at now when once you, it's at this age to say, you're playing characters now, which is what I always was doing before, but now it's a given.
Yeah.
You're heading towards Gabby time.
Oh, good. Don't you see?
Yeah.
They can't find any weapons. Don't you know what he's doing? Can't you see? He's trying to defuse the economy. He's letting people go and they're hiring the man from the train. They got the guy who ran the railroads. Don't you see what's going on, Luke?
Well, come on, Corky. Let him go.
But it's that idea of, you know, playing these characters and doing this, it's been a great combination, like a really good year to just push the envelope. And I think that's always what I want to do,
yeah.
is to try different things and kind of always change perceptions.
And change the rhythm. You can.
Yeah, break up. It is a rhythm. It's basically saying, okay, now we hit it, you know, there, and then, you know, hit a little harder and then back off and then go berserk, like, you know, with the stand-up, which is just free form, and then come back and play something so controlled, like in 1 hour photo. Those are all possible. I mean, I was trained at Juilliard, you know, I went for 3 years and left. And then, you know, went and did stand-up. But the stand-up was always just kind of a great release. And then still having that ability to play, you know, both. And having that range really helps. For me, it's great. And you mentioned the other part, having great friends and family that just make life extraordinary. And a world to still go out and see and learn about, which is the most important of all.
What's the difference in terms of a very finely sculptured performance in a movie like Insomnia, mm-hmm. like 1 hour photo, and standing up like this before a huge audience
two different mediums. I think it's like, it is like, it's almost like sculpture, because in a movie like 1 hour photo, it's like sculpting in that sense. You look for the detail, the minutiae, and all the fine points, and then in something like that, it's more like a piece of music, like a jazz riff where you just go off. Where you start off with a bass line and then you go off into these things, and sometimes when it really works, you don't know where it's going, but it's amazing. Like the golf thing came from a riff. It started off, and when you find that, it's like, wow. And it is this immediate kind of endorphin thing of, wait a minute. And it takes you there.
You can get in a zone here.
Oh yeah, big time.
Where there's nothing like it.
Yeah, there's a zone where it's possessed. It's a bit thing of...
yes, it owns you don't own it.
Yeah, so it's a bit like, oh, no! You feel like there'll be, someone waiting on the side. Come back, child. Put the butter down. Michael, put the baby down. Take the bag off the child's head and step away from the balcony, Michael. Oh,
I don't know.
You know, there was no mother.
Can you explain that to me?
I don't know. I mean, there was no mother there, because no mother in the world would let me. Honey, I'm just going to take the kid and dangle him over the balcony. Are you okay with that? I know there's, especially not a black woman, go, give me that baby, give me that baby. Crazy little man. You little elf. Don't be dragging our baby and hanging over there with your bag over his head. Yes,
that's true.
It's like,
that would have slapped him up against the exactly.
Mm-mm.
Not with my girl child.
Not my baby.
Not my child.
Here's a doll. Drag the doll. Hold the doll upside down and you have my one toe. Look at my baby. Let go of that baby. Give me that baby.
That was like, I went, ooh,
You know that there was no woman like that.
Yeah, there's nobody nearby going, like, even an old Irish nanny go, oh, dear, step away from the child. Oh, Lord above, have you been possessed? Walk away from the baby there and take off that elephant baby thing there.
Are you not an animal?
Why are you covering the child? You want to show the baby or don't? Don't put a bag over its head. What are you doing there? You're like putting a tiny burka.
What is going on in his head?
Don't know. I think he's about to jump species. I think it's like he's leaving slowly but surely. Just
it's a great
little
scene.
Thing
I just did this piece with Christopher Walken for 60 minutes, too. You love him?
Oh, the most amazing man.
He is.
He's just, an eccentric in every sense of the word, and just like the guy you just want to sit and just watch.
You do.
You can sit and watch him do anything. I mean, he did that great video where he was dancing.
Yeah, right.
Because he was an ex-Broadway he's a hoofer.
You know everything. That's right.
Not everything, but the few
almost,
things.
Yes. Yeah,
working on that in human genome. We know that we have a tail.
Exactly.
You and I have a tail, and you know what?
You've been watching.
I'm cleaning my oven while we spend
this last night's show.
Yeah, and they're saying that we're close to mice. And I think, a lot of people say we're close to mice. And I don't think that, But, a lot of people like that. And you look at a lot of people and saying, yeah, rats. Yeah, you can say, you look at certain agents and people and you say, yeah, rats. Okay, we're closer to rats. But, I thought myself, I can find cheese. I can go through the maze. That whole thing that we're close to a certain...
It isn't a weird thing that they say that they match us up. Before it was a fruit fly, now we're up to mice.
And there's not much difference.
Oh, yeah, not at all. But soon they'll have designer jeans. You can say, this is my boy, Gil.
Hi, Dad. How are you?
How are you doing? You can pick out, I'd like the boy with the lizard eyes. Honey, do we want gills for the kids? Yeah, Bob, gills. What else? Web feet for diving. Mm-hmm. What else,
Christopher Walken. Back to Christopher Walken for a second.
Speaking of human engineering. Yeah, that's
exactly right. There's a great moment where Woody comes in. I've forgotten which movie. And Woody's talking to him. You remember?
He says, I have this thing where I feel like I'm going to drive off the road. I'm going to kill myself, and the car's in flames, and the next shot is him just...
And there's another scene where Woody says to him, I'm sorry, I've got to go. I've got to go. I'm going back to planet Earth.
Well, there's people like him, and you talk to Chris. It's like, I don't know, it's... He just is... He says things, you just go, wow. There are people. That's why, coming to New York and walking around, you just see amazing people. Yeah. You see so much, so many things here. And, you see Chris and you see, but everywhere, there's so much to pick up on.
What's always amazed me about you is many things, but it is the spectrum of your interest. I mean, science is an interest of yours.
Always, kind of fascinated by it. It's kind of, my brother started off as an optical physicist and then teaches science in Memphis.
Optical physicist.
Yeah, basically. What's that? Yeah. I'm always kind of fascinated by it and, the potential for it, especially when they're talking about the human genome.
Yeah.
Well, the things of, working on, send in the clones.
Yeah.
What are you doing? Nothing. I met a Nobel Prize physicist. He said, what did you do? I developed a specific gene therapy for a very specific form of cancer, and it really will solve our problems for the next 20 years. And he said, what are you doing? I said, I'm just having lunch. But you meet them, and they're very, very kind of quiet people who've solved the problem.
We're figuring out how the brain thinks.
Yeah, we're basically, I've worked out, total neurosystem. Yeah. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm fine.
And what do you do?
Yeah,
I talk on television.
I make noises.
I talk on television.
Yeah,
I make noises.
Yeah, I make noises. Yeah. Yeah, Peter Lorre says, I make faces. I like to make faces. Why won't they let me into there? I never did anything wrong. And it's never hurting any of us.
Where was that from?
It was, actually, he had a couple, but it was an M, which was, but that was in German. But he did a monologue once on a television show where he talked about, my head is like a fishbowl, and everyone sees inside of it. I can't imagine Ed Sullivan going, how is Peter Lorre right now doing a wonderful monologue from Psycho, doing an incredible sociopath.
What musical instruments do you play?
I tried to play the saxophone once, and they had this wonderful black saxophone player who said, don't hurt it. You're hurting the instrument,
Be kind to it.
Be kind, yeah. You don't, finger it. Treat it like a woman, not like you're trying to grab yourself. It sounds like a whale being, sodomized. Let it go. My favorite is you listen to those old blues records. Like you and Bonnie Raitt's going out to find all these great old blues artists.
Yeah. I remember there were 1927. I had just gotten out of prison for the seventh time. I wrote this song called Stay Away From Me. I can't remember all the other words, but this song was written after a night of lovely evening with a woman who I found out later on was a man. But we had ourselves some wonderful love.
Yeah.
It was all you never know.
Before I found out that night,
I looked down in your thighs. You greeted me with a happy surprise. I didn't know.
And it's all, for me, I would love to play music, but I haven't had the skill or the learning. Or as Peter Cook said, I'd love to be a lawyer, but I never had the learning. I never had the learning for that.
But did you have the ear for it?
Somewhat. I just didn't have the hand for it, the ability to kind of play it,
But to do what you do.
Yeah, there's a musicality to it.
There is a musicality.
Yeah, there really is.
There's rhythm, there's musicality, and there's a pitch.
There is.
Yeah.
Some people are higher pitch. Some people pitch like that. Some people pitch and catch.
Do you paint?
No, I wish, but no.
Do you create art at all other than what you do as a performer?
I paint visually. I dance. I haven't painted. My mother used to sculpt, but I never did. Yeah.
But you read a lot.
Yeah, that's my main thing is reading and kind of sampling. As my lovely wife says, dust jacket literate. I'll just be kind of halfway through going, okay, that's enough.
Yeah,
but it's good, especially now, you know, reading all these different histories of, like, you know, start reading about the Crusades going, okay, wait a minute, there's a bit of repetition going on here. Yeah. And you start to read all about, you know, that gives me a sense of things repeating, which is not good. But, and science, once again, of, you know, global warming.
The Coyote Accord. No, it's Kyoto, George. That's a good car. No, that's Toyota. No, she's a great singer. No, that's LaToya.
You know, I'm just going, forget the dysphagia. Come over here, son. Work with me.
Dad, can I do this?
No, you could can't. Do an hour on Bush.
Oh, everyone can. I mean, that's, but, you know, behind the, you know, the malaprops and everything else is a man who, why they sent him out to basically win the Senate, you know. He works one-on-one, you know, like my, have you seen Travels with George?
Yes.
He's charming. He's charming.
It is. It is.
He works you.
You
he works
know
people.
He has something that most politicians don't. In terms
the
of
the ability
way.
To go. And it's different than, you know, Bill Clinton had a one-on-one, but he was able to multitask, you know, like crazy. Like he could be going, you know, Charlie, I believe that, well, that's over there. There's a little bit of Auburn, and look at the ass on that girl. But, you know, he was able to go like, oh, you know, like Terminator. Not want, but yet still, I believe. But George just works you like, you know, hey, how are you, buddy? Yeah. Good to see you. And I feel good. And people, and you could see it even, you know, on the camera, because she's using a video camera, picks up even more
this,
of that.
This is a movie called Travels with...
Travels with George.
Travels with George.
By Nancy Pelosi, his mother's...
Yeah, Nancy Pelosi.
Yeah.
No.
Barbara Pelosi, Nancy... No, Barbara Boxer, Nancy Pelosi.
Yeah. People it was Alexandra Pelosi.
Alexandra Pelosi, and Nancy Pelosi's daughter.
Nancy Pelosi. Who's now Journeys with George, I guess.
Journeys with George. Journeys with George, my travels with Charlie. Conversations with Uncle Phil.
Boy, I remember, oh, that gun if... That thing, the Supreme Court, it wasn't us. I thought it was like a menu. I picked two. Who knew?
It was like the Supreme Court. Hey, see him around. See him now. Move it now. Constitution's not your sketch.
Crystal directs, makes movies.
I would never do it. I couldn't.
Won't.
No, I do. I would. The first time I said, well, that really didn't work, they'd just go, what about Popeye? Okay. I got you. Done. Thank you. Nice for playing. New deal.
No. Got you me. Don't mean that. You do
no,
not.
No, I couldn't do it. I mean, I'd be willing to try so much that, you know, at a certain day you'd have to say, we have to do something else. And I'd say, oh, let's try that. Let's try this. Yeah. It'd be like a fractal rather than a movie. It'd kind of go off on all these tangents.
So you couldn't keep a strong narrative, or you couldn't...
Yes, that's the difficulty. Couldn't keep a strong narrative. Go back to the story.
Or someone might say a linear.
Linear. Linear is a very good
linear's
word.
Linear's not a word.
It'd be more like... Oval.
Oval.
We're back here again.
Oh, linear accelerator. It'd be like this thing of, what was that? I don't know.
Yeah.
But you need people who have a great sense of that to make a good movie, to make a great movie. It really has an ability to see micro and macro both. That's what I've seen with the great directors.
Who's the best you've worked with?
Oh, there have been so many. I mean, they all are different and, you know, they... Like people like Gus Van Sant, who's just so quiet. Yeah. But in the end, he achieves everything by that kind of, you know, oh, that was good. And then he just says the right thing. Oh, and directors like, you know, I've just worked with Mark Romanek, who'd done videos all this time, very, very much intense, hardcore Kubrick part two, you know, this, I want this and this. Christopher Nolan, who's very young and very, you know, but
Christopher Nolan did Insomnia?
Yeah, right. He has the ability just to be the same thing. It's almost like Gus that way. And Altman, who would try everything, and someone said working with Altman's like, it's like when someone pushes you over the cliff, you don't know what you're doing, but you're sure interesting screaming on the way down. But he had a great sense of just letting you build it yourself, which is, and stepping in if you needed it. Or Mike Nichols, the great comedy director who...
How did he direct?
He directed by basically saying that works, that doesn't, and just kind of stepping in, because you have faith that he knows comedy, especially when he's working with Elaine.
Yeah.
And for me, seeing them and seeing the old tapes of them is like watching a beautiful ballet.
The two of them together
are so amazing.
It is. It's just that, and also Carl and...
And Mel.
Mel.
Carl Reiner, Mel Brooks.
Those two combinations, for me, says everything you need to know about.
He's at Billy Crystal's 50th, he's at a birthday party. And all of a sudden, Billy leans over and says, and every table had a lamp with a shade. He says, I bet you $100. He puts that shade on his head in the next 5 seconds. I go, you're on. all of a sudden, hey, Billy! Gets on his head. And went, here you go.
Like, you know.
You know. You know a room. You know, that's all of a sudden, that's it. That's the thing. That's the job.
Let me mention this one more
time.
No,
you've done enough. You've done enough. It's online already.
There you go.
Here you go. Let me mention this. Charlie Rose, coffee cup. Beautiful thing. It's fun. Okay. Oops. It's here it is. Got the cup right there. It's beautiful. It just had coffee in it. It's a beautiful man. The Charlie Rose coffee cup. Right there. Right. And the Charlie Rose merchandising. Come right there. Got a little set of coffee cups and a tiny valve on the side there.
Yeah, right. Little pig valve.
Little pig valve.
Oh, yes. Yeah, he's doing well, too.
Is it? That's good. That's good. Yeah. The pig?
Yes.
The pig got your old valve? No. How's the pig doing? Bobby, not running so well. Come on over here, boy. Come on, boy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's always
This
wonderful.
Is always good. I always feel like this is like therapy, but fun. We always feel there should be a 1-800 number at the bottom. How much money have we raised?
Please exactly.
Support the United Caucasian College Fund.
Come in and have a little chat with Dr. Rose.
Dr. Rose. Dr. Rose will help us without the feeling of, oh, you don't know what you're doing. Men who love chickens and the women who baste them. No, thanks.
Thank
Good
you.
Day, well. Thanks, Charlie.
Thank you.
The best.
Much. Robin Williams for The Hour. See you tomorrow night.
Not all startup companies get started on Wall Street. Our local bottlers in South Africa have funded 3,500 small store owners, serving the people far from town, satisfying a thirst for a better future. The Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
We are PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose for Christmas, a great actor, Daniel Day-Lewis, a great director, Martin Scorsese, and their new movie, Gangs of New York.